Welcome to Neighborhood Game Club. I am here in Twitch Streamer's Lair. We're gonna be talking about PC gaming, World of Warcraft, Twitch streaming. We got this cat who's a hardcore video game player. What's its favorite game? All right, I'm changing the guest. This is not gonna be about the cat. This is gonna be about my friend Meghan. Check it out, it's Neighborhood Game Club.
Meghan, and on Twitch TV, I am Snugzmeow, and I am a full-time Twitch TV partner and cosplayer.
See, I don't follow Twitch streaming or PC gaming at all, so this is a very, like, fancy, cool setup. You have, like, okay. Three cameras, a mic. Tell me about it.
You're probably, like, wondering at first, like, what could all of these cameras be looking at? But recently, something I've been doing on my Twitch stream is I've been streaming my entire process of making cosplays, which is sometimes a little bit nonsensical because most of the time I never plan anything and just literally kind of make it up as I go. And so that requires me working on the floor. So that's why all these various cameras are like pointed so that you can capture like me literally like sprawling on the ground, like just cutting random stuff and mostly burning myself with a glue gun like over and over again. The rest of them are basically for when I'm like playing games at my computer. This is like my main face cam, and that is Sir Pounce, and he's coming in because literally this cat, every time he hears me standing at or talking in front of my computer, he assumes that I'm doing my broadcast, which means he may get some treats, he may get some love, so he comes in to make an appearance.
Do you have one camera set on his little...
Actually, yeah, thing? I was gonna say, this camera has dual purposes. Sometimes it's pointed on the ground for when I'm doing my cosplay making, but then at other times it's pointed this way to go for his cat house. When we play like horror games and stuff, I'll put him next to me, so we'll have like cat reaction cam, and mostly it's just me being horrified and him just like sitting there, stone face. It's pretty funny.
Well, they should make a horror game just for cats. All the bad guys can be dogs. Look at him. He's so like used to the camera. He's a little star.
He actually... Well, there's a story behind that too. He's a retired show cat and breeder. So basically for the first 2 years of his life, his job was to be in cat shows and be beautiful and to like hook up with other cats.
Can he speed run Zelda?
I wish. He's the farthest he's gotten is he's played a little H1Z1 and like actually was kind of running for a while by himself in the pretty correct direction.
So you have two monitors, one you use to play games, and this other one is this where you monitor your chat and your Twitch.
Yeah, stream? Exactly. So that's kind of what I have pulled up right now is a part of it. And believe it or not, when the stream's going, there's probably like 8 different windows on this monitor, which gets a little hectic, but that's honestly what you have to have going on to have like a top of the line Twitch stream, I guess. Because people don't want to just be sitting there watching you like talk to yourself at the computer. Like they want engagement, and engagement comes through like, oh, we've gotten this many followers, or oh, so and so usually donated something, a very small amount with a very rude message, which people like me to read out loud, which is, you know, that's cool. I'm down with it.
All right, cool. And then outside that, you also do cosplaying?
Yeah, we have... This is kind of like my, I guess, dressing room area. It's usually never this neat because it's literally like pile of fabric, pile of clothes, pile of things I tried on to maybe wear while I was streaming and then decided not to wear. In the corner here, we've got like in-progress cosplay going on. I'm making a...
Murloc?
Yeah.
Can you do a Murloc sound? I'm putting you on the spot, but I want to hear
your... It's like... Like, I'm working on it.
Wow.
I'm getting it.
Okay, that's better than I could do. Very cool.
Over here, we got, like, kind of, like, little Pokemon shrine going on. I'm a big fan of Pokemon.
Is that a World of Warcraft staff?
Yeah, this is from WoW. It's a little messed up right now because I'm redoing the lighting in it, but this is the Exodar life staff, which is, like, probably one of the most recognizable staffs. He truly is a diva. Like,
all right, very cool. All right, we'll talk about World of Warcraft, PC gaming, cosplaying, your cat, Twitch streaming, anything else, any other topic?
Nope, that's pretty much my life.
We'll talk about Glover. Welcome to Neighborhood Game Club, the podcast portion of the show. I'm sitting here with Meghan,
hi,
aka Snugs.
Yes.
Snugsmeow, Snugspow, whatever you want to call
all
her.
Snugs.
All right, so I'm stoked about this because, again, most of the show will be about like console gaming, retro playing, like collecting, but this we're getting all digital, we're entering the Matrix. She's a Twitch streamer. We're sitting behind her very lavish Twitch, like, sanctuary. Before we get into Twitch streaming, the reason I know Meg is because I met her at, like, a convention 1 year, but she is hardcore into World of Warcraft, or
yes,
at least was.
Yes.
And I also was way hardcore into WoW. So we're going to talk about World of Warcraft. How many years did you play WoW for?
So if we're counting, like, I'm still currently subbed to WoW. So even though I haven't really been on WoW, like, in the last 6 months, like, I haven't, like, ended my subscription. So I think I'm going into, like, year 7 of playing WoW, which is pretty crazy because when I started in Wrath of the Lich King, I, like, certainly wasn't a new player. Mm. I was somebody who was, like, coming in the beginning of the third expansion. But now to think that there's been 3 expansions since then, like, people are like, wow, you started in Wrath of the Lich King?
Like, see, like,
those were good times for WoW.
With me, I started in vanilla WoW. So,
yeah,
like, for you to say Wrath of the Lich King, I feel like that's when I kind of, like, was getting out of it.
Yeah.
But no, but again, this game has been out, came out 2004, 2005. And even before that, it was in, like, alpha for a year. So this,
yeah,
game is, like, 12 years old. But then I also have friends who played EverQuest in, like, the 90s. So it's, like, for us to talk about WoW, they're like, oh, you kids.
Yeah,
whatever.
Oh, exactly.
So, like, World of Warcraft, the former cultural phenomenon, because now it's been replaced by, like, League of Legends and, like, all this other stuff.
Sad. MOBAs.
But, yeah. So how did you get into World of Warcraft? Like, what pulled you in?
All right. I think a lot of people can share this story is I had a significant other who played World of Warcraft, and there would be so many days where I'd be there watching him and, like, do my own thing, like, reading or playing. Like, I played a lot of, like, single-player computer,
yeah,
games at the time. And I'd be like, why are you always playing that game? Like, what is it? What about it is, like, drawing you in? And after so many days of being like, it can't be that fun. It really can't be that fun. I sat down and I tried out World of Warcraft. And I want to say literally within, like, 15 minutes, the quest and reward system, like, had completely addicted me.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And I was like, okay, I need my own account. I need my own account, like, right then. And that was literally my first time playing. And I get, like, a little nostalgic, almost misty-eyed thinking about it. I can remember that first quest I did when I was a gnome with pink hair. And I was like, yeah, this is me. I'm short. I'm a gnome. And I was outside Ironforge, like, just killing wargs. And I was like, damn, this is the greatest thing I've ever done.
See, I think that's an important distinction with me. Well, I guess first I'll talk about how I got into WoW. Is the weirdest thing with, like, again, I mostly play console games.
Yeah.
When WoW was out, I was playing Halo 2 with friends. So, like, different, it was a different area. And then, strangely enough, the way I got into World of Warcraft is at my high school, when I was a freshman, all the water polo kids played WoW.
Oh.
Which, like, right, like, all the, like, again, like, these kind of, like,
actually, that's big in Orange County. Like,
yeah.
That's big
in
Orange
County. Again, I'm in California. And, yeah, so all the water polo, all the swimming team, they all,
yeah,
played World of Warcraft. And which is, like, weird because you'd think it'd be, like, nerdier kids. But then I had a few good friends in that group, and they're like, hey, you should play WoW. And, like, so it was, like, these sports kids who convinced me to play WoW.
That's funny, because, like, my group of, like, friends that I, like, kept in touch with over my whole WoW gaming experience, they all live here, and they all do athletics, and they all play WoW.
I think,
like,
I
think there's a lot of people, especially in this area, who, like, value sports and sport-like competition, but also love video games, probably starting with World of Warcraft.
I think what it is, like, the reason I had fun with World of Warcraft, and I think the reason it caught on in such a viral way, is WoW is most fun when you're playing with friends.
Yeah.
And so, like, that, like, with all these sports kids, you know, they're all already a big team, they're already,
exactly,
talking all the time. And then if a few kids are like, oh, you should play World of Warcraft together, you know, the whole team is like, all right, let's,
yeah,
play. So then they're talking, you know, that like, family is, like, always together. And then they infected the rest of the high school.
Yeah. Because
this was, like, I think 2005. So, like, this was, like, before WoW bloomed. And so, yeah, I started playing. And then I got my, like, a lot of my nerd friends start playing. And then, like, fuck, like, half the school was playing World of Warcraft.
I mean, it's funny you say, like, in 2005. Because, mm-hmm, I feel like that kind of happened again during Wrath of the Lich King.
Yeah.
Because I remember, like, I started playing and, like, I got my girlfriends playing, and these were girls that had never even, like, I growing up played console games and for a long time had enjoyed video games. These were girls that had never touched a computer, and suddenly they were going out to GameStop, they were getting the battle chest, so they were getting, like, the first game in Burning Crusade, and then they were upgrading to the Wrath of the Lich King. And, I mean, I think at one point I had, like, six or seven of my girlfriends from my hometown playing World of Warcraft, which was completely unexpected, but, like, a lot of them were saying the same thing. Like, they enjoyed the quest system. They enjoyed the reward system. They enjoyed, like, putting on the different clothes.
Yeah.
getting money. Like, that's a really exciting part of World of Warcraft, earning gold. Like, that gets people in there.
A big thing with, like, World of Warcraft, and a lot of RPGs specifically, but, like, is that it's a psychological effect where, you turn the first quest, this huge sound effect, boom, boom, like the explosion lights.
It's rushing.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's that. Like, yes. So, like, oh, you turn this in, your numbers explode, level two, like, huge fireworks explosion.
Yes.
Okay, you play for 10 more minutes, boom, boom, trumpets, you're level three, turn a quest, your numbers are getting up, and, like, it's genuinely fun, but that's what you're chasing, is that, like, oh, constantly leveling up, and then, you know, months later, you're at the other side of it, where it's, you're slaving away for many more hours to still chase that high, but then
you want to get that. Oh, you want to get that piece of armor that you really wanted that not only looks cool, but, like, also gives you, like, one better stat
and
than the
purple.
Current piece of armor that you have.
Because you start white and then
chasing
green,
epics.
And then it just blows up. But yeah, like, and it's funny because I at every expansion I had a character with a high cap. Like, I had a level 60, you know, then level 70, 80, blah, blah. But, like, my friends and I, we never took the game seriously. Like, I never hardcore raid or anything. We would max out on every server, have 10 alts. We would just have alt accounts that we would dick around with constantly.
Yeah.
Messing with new players, running dead mines, like
dead mines.
And I think what it was is we enjoyed that rush of, like, loving, creating a new character, getting 1 through 10, like, in a day. Again, hitting all those, like, level ups and caps, getting that psychological fulfillment. And then once we got to, like, Deadwoods or whatever, like level 20 when it's starting longer, Stranglethorn, we would just make a new character. Fuck it, let's go back and make it easier.
Duskwoods, I think that's...
yeah, Duskwoods,
yeah.
And, like, I love that zone. But, yeah, with, like, that game and a lot of MMOs I've played, it's so fun making a new character because you just level up so much faster. You're overpowering everything. A lot of people play games, they enjoy the thrill when it's challenging. I like when things are easy. I just like destroying everything. Like, it's fun for me. So I have a very strong connection to Elwynn Forest, like the Alliance starting zone, and especially that first...
Who doesn't?
I don't know, I played this game for like 8 years. I played all the way from Vanilla WoW till Pandas or whatever, Pandora.
Damn.
And by the time Panda came out, I like was over it.
Yeah.
And my friends and I, we would always, again, always with my friends, once like that core group of friends, like once a few of them stopped subscribing, then like we would fall out. I'd have one friend who would still play WoW every day until, like, you know, just recently. But, like, and then we
get... I think that's when a lot of those faithful people are like, can't do it anymore.
Yeah, exactly. Once all your friends run away. But, yeah, so we would play games for, like, and when we'd play, like, 3 months hardcore every day, talking, playing. And then we kind of fall off. And then, like, a few months would go by, we get nostalgic for it. And then, all right, let's play again. And then back, you know, for 6-7 years. But I also had fun playing WoW. Like, even by myself, I would listen to podcasts, I would listen to music, I would watch, like, because I had dual monitors, so sometimes I'd watch movies or TVs in the background, and, like,
that's
it was,
what I would do.
Yeah, it was
I
this,
love that.
It was this, like, relaxing hobby. So, like, what did you do? Because, wow, I probably put maybe at least 2,000 hours into it. Like, outside of the social aspect or hardcore rating, what did you do, like, while grinding or, like...
So, for me, I'm, like, the exact opposite of you. Mm. I have one character that is level capped, and that is the one character that I enjoy playing.
Yeah.
I have alts. I have, like, 90 alts and 85 alts and stuff, but honestly, like, I never felt that connection to them like I do to this one character, and that character is Snugzmeow, which is where I got, like, my OG gaming name.
What class and race is it?
It is, originally, was a gnome mage,
okay.
And then about... a year and a half into playing was when Alliance was, like, really, really, really bad.
Yeah.
In Wrath of the Lich King, and so our guild faction transferred, and I became a Blood Elf Mage. So if people ask me, like, what character in all the games do you feel, like, most connected to, it is my Blood Elf Mage, Snugzmeow.
Oh,
like,
wow, okay.
I love that character. I won't ever faction or race change it again. Like, that is...
And this is even deeper.
My character.
And I feel bad for people who don't care about WoW, because this is, like, nonsense. But, like, what spec was your mage that you, like, focused so hard on?
Well, so it's changed a lot, okay, because with WoW, it, like, changes patch to patch. So I leveled Frost, obviously, but, like, the best time was during Wrath of the Lich King when I was playing Arcane Mage.
Oh, okay.
So, wow, like, that was best times. Like, I enjoyed that so much. And I love Northrend. So I think a lot of people feel most strongly about the expansion that they started playing in. But I think a lot of people really liked Wrath of the Lich King.
I think Lich King was when WoW was at its peak. Yeah. It was like 2008, 2007, whatever.
It came out in 2008, okay, and I started playing like literally on the last couple days of 2008. So like 2009 was when I like first started getting like, I first got my level 80, like was right at the beginning of 2009.
Yeah, I think that's when WoW had like 11 million subscribers. Yeah. So that's when it was at its peak. And yeah, Lich King was like, I all my friends were playing it.
It was the best story too. Like I mean, you really wanted to kill the Lich King. By the end of it, you were like, yeah, this is awesome. I'm in no other expansion have I felt like that connected to like wanting to just, I guess, maybe in Cataclysm a little bit, but honestly, like, that was when my guild fell apart, like, kind of for the first time. So, like, I never killed Deathwing.
See, this is, I'm gonna annoy, I feel like, a lot of parkour WoW nerds. I never, like, did endgame stuff, so, like, I didn't care about Lich King or anything. Yeah. I was focused on killing Hogger, a level 9 elite in Elwynn Forest. Damn. My friends and I, we would spam, like, the level, you know, the level, like, 1 through 10 chat, being like, we're starting a raid on Hogger, we need everyone in the zone to team up. We would just do that constantly.
Dude,
just...
and people get satisfied, like, there's whole role-playing servers where people just, like, hang out in Elwynn Forest literally all day, and, like, that's where they derive all their enjoyment.
There's another role-play server my friends and I found, I don't even know if this is still active, but, like, when we found out that there was a specific role-play server that in Elwynn Forest and Goldshire, it was like a sex role-playing server. Oh,
that's like a WoW urban legend.
No, we actually played it. Oh, you can probably look up forums, but yeah, there was one server in World of Warcraft, a role-play server, where the...
I think it's Featherguard, or it's Moonguard, or it's Feather something. I don't know. It's Moonguard or Feather something.
Yeah, and so it was in Goldshire, you'd go into the inn, and it'd be 100 people all with their clothes off, being
it's
like...
It's Moonguard.
Yeah, looking for sex slaves, or looking for girlfriends to like... And like,
oh, I had people hit me up with the looking for the in-game girlfriend all the time.
But like on that server, so we would just message people and fuck with it. And it was like, because we would do that stuff. Again, we were 14-year-olds. So of course we were like perverse and ridiculous.
Yeah, like...
But like we would do that on like we would do that regularly and people would get annoyed with us. But then going to a server where it was just all people like us, it was like, oh, this is weird.
I think the best part about playing WoW is like when you meet someone else who's like played WoW at some point in your life, like life. You immediately have that connection, like, all right, I knew you were addicted to WoW. And
yeah,
like,
I
know exactly how you work because you were addicted to WoW. And, like, it's immediately a basis for, like, all other things. Honestly, like, I've had so many great lasting friendships.
Yeah.
And like, even relationships spring from, like, WoW as, like, the commonality in them. It's awesome.
Yeah, like...
And no other game for me has come anywhere close to that kind of community and that kind of, like, bonding over the game.
Yeah, because, like, with me, my first big multiplayer game that, like, I really got into was Halo 2. Like,
yeah.
I had probably a group of, like, 20 friends. Like, we played Halo 2 a shitload, but that was maybe 2 years. And then, like, World of Warcraft was, 6 years. Like, all these different friends on all different servers. I'd play with so many different people. And then it's also cool when you find a guild that would just, like, out of nowhere you become friends with.
Yeah, absolutely.
I played on the Something Awful forum had a guild called Goon Squad on the Horde server Mal'Ganis. And that server, it was a PvP server, but the Horde, it was like 80% Horde, 20% Alliance. So
that was all Wrath of the Lich King with bad ratios.
So
like that
was amazing because it was like you never had to worry about dying. And then I was in this guild called Goon Squad that would like, they would mess around. They would like, you know, just like grief everyone. But also like they would let you like raid with them and like help you out. Like it was such a fun, supportive, like just group to be a part of. Even though I was some like, you know, 16-year-old kid. They were all like so friendly and welcoming. So yeah, you said you found a guild. How like hardcore into it did you get?
I mean, that guild, I still talk to those people on a weekly basis. Like, most of them live in California in this area. And, I mean, yeah, like, those are people that, like, I've imagined that I'll, like, keep in touch with, like, probably for the rest of my life. Like, I couldn't see that not happening. The sad thing is, though, I'm, like, not sure guilds like that exist anymore. It's really hard to, like, go into a new community and, like, mesh into it in the way that you were able to in World of Warcraft, probably like four or 5 years ago.
And I think, again, this is what we talk about on the show a lot, is like there's just too many games to play.
Yeah.
So it's so hard to find, again, with WoW, what made this is like people play that for years straight.
Yeah.
Whereas anything today, like say even something hardcore like Counter-Strike. Counter-Strike, I played for a month. Hardcore, had a group of friends played with, amazing. But then after that month, it was like, all right, I'm gonna start playing something else. So like, and I think that happens so many times, is like people are constantly jumping from game to game to game to game, that like there's not that many games have that length where people sit, play, let a community grow. So it's really hard.
That's what that's something that I'm missing for my stream right now. Like, I got my partnership streaming World of Warcraft.
Oh, wow.
When I became a Twitch partner, like I was playing like 6 to 10 hours of World of Warcraft a day. And this was during Mist of Pandaria, mm-hmm. so like arguably like not one of the best times in WoW, but like I was still enjoying it.
Yeah.
And and so now since Warlords of Draenor came out, like I can't play WoW. And I'm almost missing something from my stream.
Yeah.
And I've gotten it by like doing a lot more variety. Like now I'm playing Counter-Strike, which I never imagined I would be playing.
Yeah, Counter-Strike is
an FPS on the computer. And actually, like I'm Gold Nova 1, so everybody who thought I was silver, I got out of it. All right. So there's that, and like I'm literally only playing that because I'm so bored of World of Warcraft.
Yeah.
And I hope that one day like the hordes of people who love WoW will go back to it. Like honestly, at this point, I really don't think it's gonna happen.
So and that's it. So I'll touch on that. Is like, yeah, my friends and I, we played WoW, and then by the time Panda came out, whatever, it was just frustrating because it's like, great, now I have to level up again. Mm-hmm. And like again, all that group of friends dropped off, so it was only like three friends. And like this, I bought Panda. I think I got from like 85 to 86. And I just stopped playing. I was done. I didn't care.
All right, I'm done.
But then like just a year ago, my friends and I, we started playing on a private server, and because again it was that like nostalgia. So we found a vanilla WoW private server. So you had to download like the old ass, like an 8-year-old client of the game.
Yep.
But it was so funny because like there was straight vanilla WoW, and then there was a times 10 server where drop rates, experience points, everything was multiplied by 10.
Damn.
And it was funny because it felt like playing WoW with cheat codes.
Yeah, which you can't do.
No, you can't. So you start out in Elwynn Forest or whatever, it's a regular server, and so like you kill the first boar. Immediate level 2. You kill 5 more, turn to the quest, you're level 6 already.
Damn.
I still finished the quest line in Elwynn Forest, and like, so I was like level, like, you immediately become great out of everything, but it was just so funny, like, basically getting to experience like the whole length of World of Warcraft vanilla WoW, as opposed to like 6 months going 1 through 60 in like a weekend. So like, it was funny, but then yeah, once you hit that end goal level, it was just like, again, they didn't have a big group of friends, so we stopped playing. But like, yeah, if I had like, again, if there was ever a day where it's like 50 friends are like, oh, let's all play WoW again, like, yeah, there's just nothing like it. You can't recreate like playing WoW in its heyday anymore.
No,
because the gaming community isn't focused anymore.
No,
love
for MMOs isn't even really there anymore because everything's online now.
Yeah, so everything all has a multiplayer aspect for it, and like, yeah, again, like there's like League of Legends and stuff. I just don't care for it. So, did you ever go to BlizzCon at all?
Yeah, I would say like that I'm kind of like one of those BlizzCon faithfuls. Mm-hmm. Because if you gave me the choice, like these cons or BlizzCon, I would be like BlizzCon always.
Really?
Always BlizzCon. And that started in 2010 when I attended my first BlizzCon, actually with my mom, because I was 16 years old, so I couldn't really go to California or go to BlizzCon by myself at that point. And it was like just such an incredible experience. I had been to 2 conventions before, mm-hmm. so this was really at the beginning of like my con going life. The first convention I actually went to was the very first PAX East, which is what really like kind of ignited my love for the gaming community, because it was the first time I realized like, holy shit, there's a lot of people who really, really like this stuff. And like
PAX East,
I'm not alone.
Yeah, PAX East is a really good convention. With conventions in general, I'm at the point now where, like, I've been going for, I think, like, 10 years, 11 years. So I'm, like, burnt out on conventions. I went to Comic-Con, like, from 2004 to 2008. Or no, so 2004 to, like, 2010. And then Comic-Con got too big.
Yeah.
So I was, like, over it. But then, like, I went to PAX and PAX East. And I think those are, like, really fun.
Yeah.
Because it's concentrated. Like, it's just gaming. There's no, like, Marvel or anything like that.
Exactly.
It's focused. It's run really well. Yeah, the community, like, it's all, like, you know, positive people. And I think that's where I met you, at like the second PAX East,
yes,
or whatever.
I think it was the second PAX, because it was not at the Heinz Convention Center.
It was at the new one.
To the new convention
center. Yeah, like you walked up to the Mega 64 booth cosplaying as like some World of Warcraft elf.
Of course.
Wearing a WoW shirt. Still when you were like enchanted by WoW. And like, yeah, we start talking about WoW, and it's like, oh, okay, let's become friends. And then, yeah, I went to BlizzCon only once. I think it was 2009. I had friends who, again, my hardcore WoW nerds friends, they flew out from Wisconsin.
Oh, yeah.
To, like, come out. And, again, it was fun, like, hanging out with your,
I flew from Boston the first time I went.
So it was fun meeting your guildmates, whatever, hanging out with your friends. And so we went there, and it was, like, exciting the first day, because it was the opening keynote where it's like, oh, Cataclysm, Diablo.
Yeah,
their
opening show is not to be missed.
Although I will say the worst part of BlizzCon was during that opening. It was, like, I don't know, 40,000 people, whatever. Every single person at the convention crammed in that expo, that one hall.
Yeah.
So like so many people, and then so we're in the back kind of standing. They announce, all right, we have a new expansion, Cataclysm, level 85. Everyone screams, lifts up their arms, and immediately we are hit by this. I know it's such a stereotype, but we were hit by this wave
nerds,
of like BO.
Nerds are spelly. I mean, that's true. Like I admit. Like, my boyfriend sometimes has to tell me, like, you need to make sure you wear deodorant to conventions. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. I need to.
Yeah, I know.
I don't know what it is about the nerd brain, but, like, sometimes personal hygiene gets neglected for the love of
yeah,
gaming.
And, like, I know it's such a lame stereotype, but,
but it's really, really true.
I don't know. People really don't shower enough, but, yeah.
Especially at conventions.
Yeah, but, yeah,
oh
at BlizzCon, they announced that everyone lifted their arms and, like, we were hit. The rest of the convention was fine, but it was just because it was 40,000 people concentrated.
All the smells.
Probably didn't sleep. We're just, like, stoked. So that was weird, but, again, whatever. And then, like, the rest of the day we walked around. Oh, you could check out Diablo. You could check out StarCraft. New WoW, whatever, and that was kind of it. Like,
yeah,
there wasn't much to do, and so like we went, and then we did go to the second day, but only for a little bit, and so like we're kind of bummed because I was so used to like PAX, Comic Con, where
yeah.
there's so many booths, so many things to check out. Whereas BlizzCon, it was like, hey, here's the Blizzard booth. Like there wasn't much to do.
Blizzard in a way, like BlizzCon in a way, and like and a lot of people will say that like 2008 and 2009, because those are first 2 years, were like for sure the weakest of all.
Okay,
BlizzCons.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised by that.
This last BlizzCon, 2014. Was absolutely insane. Mm-hmm. Like, it's the most of the convention center that they had ever used. They had Overwatch, they had Heroes of the Storm, they had Hearthstone,
oh, yeah, okay.
They had Diablo, they had StarCraft, and they had World of Warcraft. So it was, like, three times as many games. So I would say, as Blizzard as a company has evolved, so has BlizzCon, and so has the production value.
Okay,
like, they still have all the same, like, the face painters and the Blizzard tattoos and stuff, but, like, for me, the best part of, like, the most recent BlizzCon I went to was on Saturday. We spent, like, 4 hours watching the World Championship Series for StarCraft. Mm-hmm. And, like, honestly, like, that was so energizing. And, like, the amount of money being played for and everybody making signs and, like, it being streamed on Twitch. Like, that was the best moment I've had at any BlizzCon.
Cool. Yeah.
So, it's definitely grown into, like, a bigger convention. But also, BlizzCon is loved because of the social aspects of it. Like, everybody, I mean, there's hordes of people that will tell you, like, I met my husband at BlizzCon. I met my girlfriend at BlizzCon. Like,
yeah, no.
Literally, BlizzCon is, like, a place to convene and, like, meet like-minded nerds.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's my favorite con. Because you know everybody there has probably been addicted to World of Warcraft.
Yeah.
So that's, like, that same, like, all right, we all understand, like, how gaming can control your life. So, like, let's love gaming and, like, being social together.
Yeah.
So, that commonality, because not like other conventions where everybody plays different genres.
Yeah,
you
it's
got
nice
retro
split.
Gamers,
with here it's just
consoles.
Blizzard. Yeah.
This is just, like, just people who just love Blizzard. And enough to kind of spend a lot of money.
Yeah, and I think also, like, I had one friend, again, out of all of us, who was the most hardcore into it. He loved it. Because,
yeah,
like,
exactly.
Hardcore. With my friends and I, we are the ones who, like, we fuck around on alts and WoW. We didn't care that much.
Yeah.
So it was like, but
you didn't get, like.
Yeah, but, like, again, it was like 20, the convention center was 20 minutes away from where I lived. So
exactly.
It was like, okay, let's go. So, again, it's not like I flew out, got a hotel. So, it was, again, I wasn't, like, disappointed or crushed, but it was just like, all right, I don't need to come back. But, yeah, I can see if you're way into it, then, like, sure.
Yeah.
But again, that's my experience was, like, yeah, the second BlizzCon was, like, tiny. So, before we get into Twitch streaming real fast, did you play any other MMORPGs outside of WoW?
No. Like, I had only played, like, single-player games and, like, some pretty, like, embarrassing ones. Like, I was super into Zoo Tycoon, and like, I don't care what anybody says. Like, if you sit and play a video game for 8 hours, like, you are a video gamer. It does not matter if that game is Zoo Tycoon. You are a video gamer.
My
is who you are.
Like, my girlfriend, she would play, SimSue and, like, Roller Coaster Tycoon.
Sims, Roller Coaster Tycoon.
A lot of girls play those.
Man, if I can find one other person that liked this game as much as me, and maybe from this, I can. Zeus, Master of Olympus. It was, like, an early, like, kind of Age of Empires, but more like building a little Roman city. Holy shit, I would play that game, like, 12 hours
a day. So it was, like, an off-brand, like, Civilization Age of Mythology or whatever?
Off-brand Age of Mythology, and it was truly, like, the most addictive game. And even my boyfriend at the time, who got me into WoW, he played it and was super into it.
Do you ever stream this game?
I actually have, like...
Okay, you should stream that. I'll check it out. What's it called again?
It's called Zeus Master of Olympus.
Zeus Master, okay.
You can definitely still find it on Amazon.
Now, is there a Zoo Tycoon, like, crossover called Zoo Master of Olympus? We're building zoos in Greece?
God, I wish.
Okay, so...
That would be the best game of all time.
Maybe you can talk to sponsors, get that going. Other MMOs I played... I spent 2 weeks playing The Matrix Online. Are you a fan of The Matrix movies?
Not enough to play The Matrix Online.
The Matrix Online, that game, I think, only lasted like 2 years. The servers were shut down. Gameplay-wise, it wasn't good, but like, The Matrix as like...
Shit.
Everything The Matrix represents, like trench coats, cyberpunk, like digital, like, it's so cheesy and stupid and fun. Like, The Matrix is funny, but like, everything surrounding it is so silly and goofy. Playing that as an MMO, you start... Like, level one, you spawn in a telephone booth. You walk out, it's just a million people in trench coats and, like, M16s. And you get a mission to, like, go into office buildings and shoot Agent Smiths. Like, such a lame game. But they had an emote called Slash Wedding Cake. And Slash Wedding Cake, whoever you were standing next to, you would grab them and start making out with them.
Oh, God.
So my friends and I, being the 14-year-olds we were, we made fat, like, naked dudes. And we would stand around phone booths where all the people would hang out and just slash wedding cake. And people trying to roleplay as, like, Neo would be like, ew, what the hell? You know?
Stop this.
Yeah.
You're ruining my roleplay experience.
So I wish, whatever. I know there's tons of private WoW servers. The Matrix Online, if they could bring that back. I don't know.
Whoever
really
made that game, bring it back.
Yeah, the Wachowskis.
Bring it back.
But I also played a little bit of Guild Wars 2. It was, again, you pay $20 for it and then you own it forever.
Oh, really?
So now they're going free to play.
Guild Wars at all.
The combat of that was kind of like hack and slash. Like, it was like okay, but again.
See, I don't enjoy that. The best part of WoW for me, like, obviously playing a mage is like my primary class that I played.
Yeah.
It was like,
I mean, they do have casters and stuff, but like, yeah, the combat was like, I guess, a little bit more fast paced, but like, they didn't seem, it wasn't very well structured, or like WoW has, like, especially now, not so much in vanilla, where it's like, all right, every quest line guides you to an area.
Yeah.
It's so well streamlined. Guild Wars, I felt like there's not a lot of player agency. It just dumps you.
I could not have done that then.
There's a trillion quests, a lot of collectibles. It was just like a giant map of stuff you discover and quests to do, and it was just like, I had no motivation, and I only had, like, two other friends who played it, so...
Yeah, and it wasn't...
I don't know. I didn't like it that much, but Final Fantasy XIV, have you played this at all?
Haven't played Final Fantasy, but I follow a couple people who play, and, like, I'm always looking at their screenshots, and I'm like, damn, that game looks fun. But I'm like, no, that's too much right now.
I think you're missing out on WoW in the community. There is a free trial, you should try it out. But like, Final Fantasy XIV, I started playing a year ago. When I started playing it, like, I played other older Final Fantasies, but you can play that game not knowing anything. Like, it's Japanese developed.
Yeah, which is why I really, really like the art style.
Yeah, art style. You can be a cat girl. Yeah, it's so cute and
exactly.
Silly. There's transmogrifying. You can dress up and stuff. Like, it's so...
That's what I've seen a lot of the screenshots
from. It's so cute
from.
And silly and fun. The music's great. Like, it's... All the Final Fantasies and monster designs are great. But yeah, Final Fantasy, it's Japanese developed, but like, it's not like Korean sensibility. It's not a huge grind-a-thon. It's very like casual, friendly. And then when you want a hardcore raid, then yeah. But like... You can level up super fast. There's only one character. You only make like one character, but that character can learn every single class.
Oh,
so you can
okay.
switch classes cool. and like level up. So
well,
it's like,
I like that. I like the one character system.
I have a cat girl named Woody Allen.
Awesome.
Who is modeled after like Madoka from that anime. So
awesome.
It's like this cute little cat girl, and it's like I've spent like a year just like just staring at her butt as she levels up, and it's like
it's been a great year.
I love so I don't know, Final Fantasy 14 is great. I have like a dozen friends who play it, but yeah, I feel like you should, are either with your streamers or even through me, like you should try playing on my server, try it out. It's such a fun game.
And you know, I'd be like, honestly, at this point, willing to, like, my only other experience with MMOs was a Star Wars The Old Republic, which I was pissed off because I bought it with the intent to play it on my MacBook, mm-hmm. but like they didn't release it for Mac.
That's the
and
thing.
And so I literally was like, all right, so my old PC can't run this because it's too graphically complex. So like I literally bought it and was completely unable to play. And then I was just like, I hate your whole series. I hate your whole series.
That's why like PC gaming, I mean, outside of like WoW, PC gaming and like Twitch streaming, all of it's so alien to me is because like, throughout high school, I had a PC, not a very well-built one.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. I got at Costco.
WoW, you could run WoW, you could run Counter-Strike.
Anything could run WoW.
Yeah, and that's why it was so successful, is they made it so anyone could run it. So in China, anyone could play it. But yeah, so I never played that many PC games. And then, like, I started getting into, like, video production editing, and I liked how Macs just handled stuff.
Exactly.
So I got a super souped-up Mac that I use for video editing, but, like, still can't play that many games. But WoW and a few other things are optimized for Mac.
Yep.
But yeah, that's why I'm kind of like walled out of PC gaming.
And honestly, that still happens. Like most recently, this game called H1Z1 came out into alpha, and it was available on the Steam store. The Steam store is for Macs and for PCs. Nowhere on the game information did they say it didn't work on a MacBook. Thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, people bought it for their MacBook and were in a loop of opening it and opening it again and it never working. And I was like, I can't believe there was like no communication. Like, by the way, this is not going to work for your MacBook. Like, that to me was like almost offensive.
Yeah.
That they like didn't put that on the Steam store, that it wasn't compatible for Macs.
I was bummed too, because like when Diablo 3 came out, it was supposed to be, hey, for Macs also. So I got super excited, bought it. It ran like shit on Macs. And like, it wasn't until like...
Dude, I wrecked my Mac installing Diablo 3. I'm not kidding. I had a Mac, and like, this could have just been like a total coincidence, but I installed Diablo 3 and it corrupted the hard drive, and I actually had to get the hard drive replaced in my MacBook. Like, the hardware guy was like, I don't know how the hell that happened.
Well, maybe Diablo himself.
I'm like,
maybe,
honestly,
maybe Diablo knew you were going to destroy him.
I have not
him,
played
so
Diablo 3
you.
Since that happened.
Oh man, Diablo 3, I love it.
I have not. I actually considered buying the expansion.
Diablo's good. It's very
because
good.
Because I was like, all right, I should let that go. That happened a while ago now. So like,
yeah,
maybe
no, so
I need
same
to
thing.
Let it go and play Diablo.
I bought Diablo 3 at launch. Didn't run on my Mac. So I had a boot camp. Like, which running Windows, and it didn't run as well, but I played it like 20 frames per second. It looked like shit. Played it, beat it once, whatever. And then they optimized it for Mac, downloaded it, played it a little bit more, whatever. But then they put it out on PS4, which, like, okay, great, it runs.
Yeah.
On PS,
oh, people love it on PS4.
On PS4, it's more like Gauntlet. Like, it's very hack and slash friendly. You control, you don't have to click anything.
Yeah.
You're just running around. Couch co-op, I played it with my girlfriend. Like, it, that I played it so hardcore for like several weeks. But again, none of my friends have it on PS4. They're all
exactly.
on PC. So it's like...
I mean, I just don't know a lot of people with PS4s.
Yeah.
I'm like...
Again, you're the PC. Like, with
PC
me, all my
race.
Friends... Yeah, all my friends are PS4. But yeah, so I got to Endgame Diablo 3 on PS4. Oh, this is great. I have no one to play with, so...
Yeah.
But, like, on PC, they just launched, like, a new season or whatever. So all my hard...
It's been... Yeah, it's been really popular streaming this week.
So all
which
my...
is why I consider buying
you
it.
Should, it's good.
Was like,
it's very fun.
Oh, maybe it's a good time to start playing again, and I can like finally let go that I ruined my Mac.
Yeah, so all my hardcore like PC nerds are now playing Diablo 3, and they're like, "Oh, you should play with us." But it's like, it's gonna, it's.
You're not sure if you want to open that door again.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, I honestly first I would recommend you checking out Final Fantasy 14. Make a cat girl stream it, whatever. And it's light enough to. I mean, it is addicting, but it's light enough to where it's like you don't have to grind 1,000 hours. You can, you know, like.
Yeah, that's my biggest thing. Is like I don't have time for the grind.
No.
And I don't want to do pay to win.
It's $12 a month, and like they're constantly pushing out updates. It's very good, and again, very cute and silly. All right, so now we'll get into the main reason I wanted to come to your place interview is Twitch streaming.
Yes,
and this is something we'll probably talk about a lot on my show with different people, and I think it's like probably a generational gap. Like, how old are you?
I'm 21.
I'm 24. Not huge, but I feel like the core audience of Twitch is definitely younger.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's something we'll kind of talk about. So just on the whole. I don't know, how would you even describe what you do?
So to adults, I started by going, have you ever seen iCarly?
I don't think that's a good... No, adult... I've never even said iCarly.
But okay, you'd be surprised because adults with children have seen iCarly because their kids have seen iCarly. And they go, yes, that Nickelodeon show. And if they don't go, then I go, do you know YouTube? So that's like, that's the next route. So they know iCarly. I go, well, it's kind of like that. I put on a show every day in my apartment. It's like primarily about video games and me making cosplays that like are related to video games and my fandom and like me liking anime and like cats and nerdy stuff.
That's a pretty good way to explain it.
Yeah. And so most people will like get it from that. Yeah. But if they were like, don't know iCarly. Like, all right, we're going
then it
down.
Throws everything.
We're going
off.
Down a different road. I'll be like, so you know how there's people on YouTube who just like make videos of themselves talking about stuff?
Yeah.
I'll be like, I do that, but it's live, and so it's like completely unrehearsed, and it's mostly about video games and cosplay and cat stuff. So like, and if they still don't get it after that, then I'm like, oh yeah, whatever. Like, I do stuff on the internet. Like,
I mean, like. When people say Twitch streaming to me, it's someone at their computer playing video games and people watching it. Like, that's what it is. And
but
like,
it's so much more. Like,
and you can make it more. Cause like, yeah, like my friends make it 64. Like, they do two things. Like, Garrett does like basically like a radio call in show where it's like, he's basically doing like a video game version of Howard Stern where it's like, he's like taking calls, he's like doing bits and stuff, but it's an hour. It's that and that's
and
done.
And he does that on Twitch?
Yeah. Cool. Once every Wednesday. And then, they do a podcast, which is, again, like, it's a very concentrated talk show.
Yeah.
But they don't stream themselves playing video games. But I think it's cool, like, using the medium to, like, do shows. You know? Yeah. I think that's cool. And, like, I know you're straight. Like, how would you... To people who already watch Twitch streams, how would you market your show compared to, like, the trillions of others out there? Like, what do you do specifically?
What I always tell people is I really like video games, and I've loved them, like... Probably, I would say, like, my entire life since I have, like, cognizant memories of, like, my existence. I've liked video games because I have an older brother who's only 2 years older than me. And so much of, like, my growing up was spent, like, playing with him on the N64 or watching him play on the N64. And so when people are like, okay, like, what's your brand? And I'm like, I'm somebody who's really grown up with gaming and I love gaming. I'm just not very good at it.
Yeah.
Like, it, and people are like, well, be better. And I'm like, well, I'm really trying. And then they're like, no, you're not. And I'm like, well, I really am. So I tell people I'm enthusiastically terrible at gaming.
Yeah.
Probably not terrible isn't the right word because, damn, there are some people on Twitch who are terrible at gaming. But, like, that's mostly people who are, like, putting on an act.
Yeah, yeah.
But, so I'm like, I'm generally not that good at gaming, but... I'm so passionate about it that I think a lot of people are like, okay, like, you're making up for it in your passion for your community.
Yeah, and
your
that I think that's, yeah. So, like, I'll check in on Megan's stream once in a while. I'm like, yeah, she's either cosplaying or interacting with her cat, like, or she's in costume and, like, constantly doing chat engagement, talking with people. And
well,
so
I tell people this, I'm like, people don't really want to watch video games on Twitch.
Yeah,
like,
I don't.
People want to watch you doing anything other than video games. Mm-hmm. So, like, if... And I don't think that was always the case. I think Twitch really started as, like, a cool place where people were, like, watching video game playthroughs.
Yeah.
But think about it. You can only watch somebody play through a game so many times until you've been like, damn, I've seen, like, 10 broadcasters play through this game. I'm not interested in watching a full playthrough again. And so I think partners right now and upcoming broadcasters are, like, really challenged by how can I create an awesome, engaging show about video games, but at the same time, more about the community and more about social interaction, because that's really what people are going to Twitch for.
I think definitely. Because, like, with me, I feel like that's such a huge generational gap where it's like, I have no interest. I'd rather play the video game for myself.
Exactly.
But on the other side, like, when I was a kid, I had like neighbors and friends, like, I would go to their place
and watch them play.
We'd play video games. Yeah. And they would, but like, they would we'd pass the controller off. But, like, so I get the idea of, like, having a friend, watching him play and, like, interacting. But, like, with me, because I grew up with it, it's like, it has to be, like,
Yeah. And so for me, I make, like, a lot of effort to really include my community, which some people are very strict. You must be a paid subscriber.
You must
do this to play games with me.
Yeah.
But I'm, like, kind of not really about that because I don't feel like anybody should have to pay to enjoy the stuff that I'm providing to you guys, like, the content that I'm putting out. So, like, I'm somebody that will, like, definitely play with viewers,
But I'm kind of strict about it because I'm like, yo, if you're not my rank, I'm not playing with you. but that's like, that's because I enjoy playing games where I'm like with people who, of my own skill level. Like, that's just my personal gaming preference. But yeah, so my focus on really like making it about the chat and making it about the community is honestly like what makes my channel and also what allows me to do it every single day. Because if it was just me sitting in front of my computer, just like droning away, like playing a game, also, I probably like would not be playing eight hours of video games.
Because again, I never check Twitch, but every once in a while, like out of morbid curiosity, I'll go look at it. Or I've done like parodies against Twitch or, you know, stuff like that. And like, that's the kind of shit that like I see and it drives me crazy. Like, how the fuck can anyone watch this? Where it's someone so laconic at the computer playing a game. And again, they're green screen in the bottom corner playing WoW or whatever. And then they're like, oh, hey, what's up, Mike? Just chatting.
People are like,
and they have 80,000 subscribers. They're getting tips and it's like, who the fuck cares? This is a like, again, not to bash, but it's just like, what? Like, I can do the same thing. Like, I don't get why people follow it. I can see Twitch for like, two ways. One is high level play. I get the whole esports aspect.
Oh, absolutely.
Walkthrough. I get that. Or like a game journalist, like, or like where it's like a brand new game. You want to see a little bit of gameplay. Great. I couldn't watch that for more than like 10 minutes. You know, like, the only time I would watch Twitch or whatever is like when Capcom or where they'd have the fighting game tournaments, the Evo, then hell yeah, I think that's rad. Yeah. That's the highest people doing their thing. But then that's it. But yeah, when it's just people, I couldn't imagine someone watching 8 hours a day. But then also, I guess realistically, I don't think anyone's literally sitting in someone else's room for 8 hours the whole broadcast. Do people do that? Do people leave in the background that long?
Yeah, they do. You would be so surprised. And I've personally not done a 24-hour stream because I'm definitely somebody who, like, encourages people to, like, pair their gaming with, like, a healthy lifestyle.
Yeah, totally.
And a healthy lifestyle includes sleeping at night and sleeping, like, and not staying up for 24 hours straight and not depriving yourself of regular meals and, like, leaving.
I just think, even just a balance and variety. Like, I love video games, but, like, I'll also watch movies, read, work,
exactly.
You know, everything.
People are, like, surprised when I tell them that, like, I enjoy watching, like, movies or TV to relax. And I'm like, that shouldn't be surprising. I play video games for my job.
I don't know.
I love gaming, but
It's a small degree, but there's definitely people, like, there's definitely, like, quote-unquote gamers where it's, like, that's the only thing they care about.
No.
And it's just, like, that's just insane. But
there's people like that with, like, every fandom.
Yeah,
like, some old lady who's, like, that hardcore about knitting that she's, like, I will knit for 24 hours straight.
Is there a knitting stream? Is there a website for grandma's knitting?
You know, actually, that's a big element of what's coming to Twitch is creative streaming. So that's, like, kind of what I'm moving into because
Because you're doing cosplay now, and I think that's cool. Because then hypothetically, people can come in, you guys can chat about techniques or whatever.
Yeah,
and you're
exactly.
saying you're getting, like, female viewers on your, like, cosplay stream?
Yeah, so basically, like, over this summer, I started streaming on a full-time schedule because I moved out here from New York City to stream. That's my whole purpose of living here. And so I noticed, like, I wasn't able to play video games for, like, 8 hours a day. One, because, like I said, I'm, like, not that good. So, like, people don't really want to watch, like, low-level, kind of noobish gaming for that long. But I am quite good at cosplaying. Mm-hmm. I've been doing it for now 5 years, so in creating a bunch of cosplays, like, I've developed my own techniques and skills. So I'm really excited that a couple months ago, Twitch introduced creative streaming, which is basically a whole new area of Twitch where you don't have to stream any video game content. What you're doing doesn't even have to be related to video games. It just has to be related to you creating something as a content creator and broadcasting and sharing your creative process.
Oh, wow.
So there's people on there who are programming on computers. There's people on there who are doing, like, visual arts, like, they're sculpting, they're glass blowing.
See, that's cool, because, like, then that's, like, almost semi-academic. People can go in and talk.
It's pretty much, like, basically bringing, like, Pinterest and Etsy to life. Like, you're seeing these people that you're always like, damn, how'd they make that?
Yeah.
And you're like, wow, that's how they made that. And a lot of times, it's not how you thought they made that.
Yeah.
Like, and I think that's the best part. And also, I've noticed that people are more respectful during those streams, and I don't know if it's because there's, like, a more serious element you're creating something. But honestly, for me, I'm enjoying moving my content to more creative streams because it's making a better community where people are not only respecting me more as a broadcaster, but also respecting each other.
I think also, if you're doing that, again, you're creating, you're doing something unique. So I think that is interesting. Another thing with, like, playing video games, and especially why I wouldn't watch someone playing a video game, is, like, what brilliant commentary can they say? Like, they're just talking over cuts. Like, it's nothing unique. Yeah. Whereas if you're making something great. But, like, yeah, that's the thing that, like, bums me, is there's a generation of kids now who will say, oh, did you play Metal Gear Solid 3? Oh, no, but I watched someone stream it. It's like, you're not getting the same experience. Like, that is, you're being robbed of an experience.
Exactly.
And even stuff like The Last of Us, like, all these games that have visceral emotional elements, like, problem solving. If you're watching someone else do that, you're not experiencing it. And so, like, when I see Twitch streaming that popularity, it, like, bums me out that, like, yeah, kids aren't, and I guess people, adults, I don't know, people aren't experiencing it for themselves.
Another, this is, like, kind of a really interesting element of my stream that, like, some people do this, but not a whole lot, is, one, because people say they're kind of embarrassed of doing it, is, like, I'll stream Just Dance.
Yeah.
And, like, I'll stream it, and, like, you best believe, no matter how silly that dance move looks, I'm gonna do it. And I'm gonna do it 100%. And honestly, it's gotten to the point where people enjoy, like, these Just Dance streams so much that I have people that come and watch me that play Just Dance and dance along at home.
Oh,
and
wow.
They're sharing, like, their scores in comparison to my scores. And if I had a Wii U, which I don't have a Wii U, but I'm getting a Wii U, I would be able to play online with them. So, like, we're kind of working in that direction. And I really like that because it proves to people, I'm like, hey, this is a video game, and it gets you to use your body.
Yeah.
And it's just as fun and in hitting, like, those dopamine, like, reward systems as any other game. So I've had people be like, damn, like, I never would have played that game, but you're so hyped when you, like, receive those stars and when you, like, get perfect moves that we're like, I'm gonna go buy this game. And I'm like, do it, because you too will become addicted and a better dancer.
I think that's cool. Again, I think, and again, that's one with Twitch streaming, like, I would never see the appeal of, there's a trillion and a half League of Legends Counter-Strike streams.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, stream obscure games, weird games. I think that's cool, like, doing Twitch stream, people posting scores and playing online will be great. But then what percent of that do you think it's just, like, and I apologize for this, but what percent of that do you think are, like, just 14-year-old boys, like, using Twitch as a way to just, like, talk to girls and just have this kind of engagement? Because there's definitely a degree
of
that.
Honestly, it goes both ways. Like, I notice in my for my chat, like, I have a mature audience filter. I swear a bit like a sailor, kind of. So, and sometimes, you know, talk about, like, more mature jokes or something, like a joke I wouldn't want to tell to a 14-year-old.
Yeah.
And so, like, I think that gets me, like, a little bit of a more mature audience.
Yeah. Or
like,
at least
I like to think so. But I think, yeah, a big portion of your audience on Twitch, and if you are a guy or a girl going into this, like, you should know that, like, a majority of your viewers are, like, male and, like, pervy. But it's the internet, and everybody's kind of a perv on the internet, like, whether or not they're gonna admit it. So, honestly, like, I just always, like, keep it, like, light and fun, and, like, I do my best to remove sexuality from it. And, like, sometimes I'll call people out, and I'll be like, just so you know, like, there are websites where there are women taking off their clothes for money. There's literally hundreds of them, and you can go to them right now. And
so that's cool. So you will kind of put down a line.
Exactly. Okay. I'm like, this is not the place for it. I'm like, if you ask me to do anything with my body for money, remove any clothing for money, like, you are not going to be a member of my chat.
Okay, like, cool. Because, like, I know there are people who are former, like, cam site models, or even former porn actresses who have, like, started using Twitch to, like, kind of, like, beg for money. And that's a part that's repulsive to Twitch to me, is, like, people begging for money. And so, like, but
and honestly, like, some of those people would be like, well, I'm doing better than Snugzmeow. Like, I'm making more money than Snugzmeow. And I'm like, all right, that's fine. But, like, at the end of the day, I'm not, like, really encouraging people to, like, give me money for, like, super, like, for reasons that make me feel uncomfortable. Like, a thing on Twitch that's really popular, which, I mean, it for men and women, is drinking for money, like, drinking alcohol for donations. And I'm honestly, like, super against that because the audience of Twitch is, like, primarily younger children, and, like, this is just encouraging, like, hardcore binge drinking for money.
Yeah.
And I'm like, really? Like, if there's anything you should not be promoting, like, it's you consuming a substance for money.
Yeah, and again, especially if the audience are, like, 13-year-olds.
Exactly.
You know?
And, like, it's even gotten to the point where, like, I saw a highlight or a YouTube recap of a guy streamer who got so wasted on his stream, peed all over his setup. And I'm like, Okay. So, okay, Twitch people, we need to, like, take it back and we need to look at ourselves and be like, this is not how we should be representing ourselves as personalities on the internet. Should not be peeing on your very expensive setup for a live audience because you're so inebriated.
That's so funny. Like, I think that's, I mean, for the Twitch streamer, that sucks. For the audience, that's, like, wild and funny. But then that doesn't lead to anything good. But
that's what people expect now.
And it's
they want to see you. They don't want to see you be a good, functioning member of society.
Yeah.
They want to see you, like, getting really messed up and again, doing something silly.
I totally
silly.
Get it. Because, again, as I said, like, when I was wild, my friends and I were 14-year-olds. We were, like,
exactly.
Total shitheads.
You would have loved that. Exactly. You would have, like, loved that.
With 4chan, it's like we'd do prank calls. Like, we were awful. And that's, of course, what we did, is we'd go online and antagonize people. So I get that there's always going to be trolls.
There's always going to be trolls.
I get it. I get
you
it.
You will never eliminate all the trolls.
But the thing I don't understand is, okay, if a lot of the audience of Twitch streams, outside of, like, esports, whatever, like, 14-year-olds, where does, like, the money aspect come from? Like, who are these people donating money? Are these kids borrowing people's credit cards? I understand if there's someone who's doing a great stream, you want to support them, okay, $5, but, like, does someone have, like, 20 subscriptions ongoing? Like, I don't understand where this income flow comes from.
Definitely. Definitely. And there's a lot of parents who are paying for Twitch subscriptions and have no idea what they are.
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, the kids, like,
reoccurring payments, and it's only $4.99. So depending on what kind of person you are, you may not, like, delve into, like, what that $4.99
charges. Oh, it's the video
charges.
Game thing. Oh, it's the Minecraft or whatever.
It's, exactly. That's what parents are writing it off as. But, I mean, I've honestly noticed, like, there's been a couple times that I've gotten a donation from somebody that I knew was a child, and I knew they donated with their parents' card, and I have refunded them.
I think that's great, because that would make me so uncomfortable.
Or I've contacted the person, and I've said, like, I know this is not your name on the card. I'm, like, pretty sure it's your parent. Like, please don't make any more contributions with their money, because...
Yeah, have you ever gotten, like, a large donation that's, like...
Actually, no. I'm quite lucky that I've never gotten a large donation charged back, because the people who support my channel and, like, make pretty large financial contributions are mostly all adults that I actually kind of know on, like, a talking basis now, that are, like, truly supporting the community because they want to see it going. But, man, you hear about that all the time.
And that's
you hear about that
all the time. More specifically with, like, iPhone games where kids will, like, charge hundreds of dollars to their parents' card.
I mean, it's the same with Twitch, is, like... If you had access to your parents' PayPal, like, you could do some serious, serious damage. And, I think by discouraging, like, people offering money, like, stand up and I'll give you $10, I miss a lot of that stuff. Like, by me immediately timing that out, like, I'm not getting, like, kids that are donating their mom's
money. But I think it's good, because, you are building up that line, you're putting respect. Yeah. I think that's important. And I think,
But it's hard, man, because I'll tell you, I've not grown as fast as some other people because I do that.
Yeah, and I mean,
And I see that, but it doesn't really bother me at the end of the day, because, like, I go to sleep and I wake up, like, feeling pretty good about what
I'm
doing.
And that's the thing, too. And, I would never, especially, like, with YouTube, I'm on the same level where it's, like, I've had, like, sponsorship opportunities, but it's, like, I don't want to, like, sell out or do something I don't want to do. And, my YouTube channel is, like, 10,000 subscribers, which is, like, comparatively nothing.
Yeah.
It's only a few little people, but it's, like, it's because I make what I want to make. I don't, like, shill out garbage.
But those are meaningful.
Those few subscribers, I read every single comment. The few people who actually watch, I care so much about, you know?
Exactly.
Like, but, I'm not going to, last Thanksgiving, or, like, 2 years ago, I got... because I am, like, a YouTube partner, so I will get emails.
Mm-hmm.
There was something where, like, Kevin Hart had a new movie coming out, and it was like, hey, we'll give you $100 if at the last 5 seconds of your video, you just plug this movie. And it was like, oh,
so shameless.
It was like...
So shameless.
It's like, no, I won't. And then I saw on YouTube some, like, random person upload a video, and all the comments were like, why the fuck is he talking about Kevin Hart? And it's like, so many people took that offer.
Dude, that's like, I'm sure you've heard about YouTube gaming.
Yeah.
This is a point that, like, I think a lot of people aren't talking about, but other Twitch broadcasters need to be more vocal about.
Mm-hmm.
There was people streaming on YouTube gaming who are Twitch broadcasters, and as part of being a Twitch broadcaster, you are only allowed to stream on, like, Twitch TV. It was obvious these people had been offered some kind of financial incentive to stream on YouTube gaming. But at the same time, they saw no repercussions on Twitch end. Twitch kept those people on for their meet and greets at events. Twitch is still inviting those people to TwitchCon. And they're still streaming on both sites.
I think,
my question for you, Twitch, when is the line, like, going to come down and say, hey, by the way, you are invalidating your contract.
I think it's because Twitch doesn't see YouTube as like a threat. Because like YouTube gaming launched, and I was kind of excited for it because that's like, I have a big YouTube, like, compared to Twitch.
Exactly.
I have a big YouTube following, so it's like, oh, I could capitalize on this. YouTube gaming launched, and it was like, the fourth most viewed stream has like 100 viewers. It's like, oh, this isn't enough.
No,
this isn't
happening. You should have seen on the day of the actual launch, I saw Twitch partners on there who were getting 3 times as many viewers on YouTube gaming as they were getting on Twitch.
Yeah.
So you can tell there's some YouTube promotion algorithm working behind it. And also a lot of financial incentives that you know are being given out to these broadcasters because they're risking their relationship with Twitch. So it's probably enough money to make that worthwhile.
And that happens in like TV film industries where people will buy out contracts.
It's
going to
happen in every single industry.
Yeah.
It's just, it always just makes you like a little bit sad because you're like, damn, I didn't expect you to be that person. But hey, everybody's got to earn, I guess.
Yeah, and that's the thing that I think another huge generational difference, the thing that like kids today aren't conscious of is the concept of like selling out.
They have no idea what selling out means.
And this blows my mind. Oh my God. This blows my mind.
Getting paid to do your job is not selling out. If your job is to be a YouTube personality or a Twitch broadcaster and you are getting paid for that, it is not selling out. It is doing your job.
So there's almost
like, oh my God.
So I understand the idea of like being paid to do a gig, great. But yeah, the idea of like giving up your own like,
it's abandoning your morals and your belief in return for compensation.
That's what selling out is.
But like, that is selling out.
But so many people don't even have that terminology in their head.
No, they're like, the second you get paid, sell out. And I'm like, how do you expect all these people to be sitting in front of $1,000 computers if they're never getting paid?
Oh, I have the opposite viewpoint. To a degree. So with like stuff like I was saying, like the Kevin Hart thing, the like with like sponsorships, whatever, people aren't calling. I even say, at least where I'm seeing, people aren't calling out sellout enough. Not that it ultimately
maybe
means
on
anything.
YouTube side. On Twitch, it's so really overboard.
I think
so
maybe because of the chat. Because like on YouTube, it's comments. Where if you write something, it's permanent. So I think comments are like a little less toxic on YouTube, whereas the chat, it's just filled with this like constant like fuck yous, whore. Like it's constant like chaos.
I mention a brand or a product I just like. I have no affiliation with them.
Really?
It's something that I enjoy and I'm recommending to my community. Guarantee you, sell out.
Really?
Okay. And I'm like, literally, I have no affiliation to this product. This is something I enjoy as a human being. And people are like, you're getting paid to say that. And I'm like, I'm actually not. Like, no one is giving me some imaginary money to say
this. Okay, cool. So on Twitch, that happens. I didn't know that. Because, like, on YouTube, I never see it.
I think that's just the live chat versus comments.
I think maybe so. Because, like, so many things are sponsored by, like, Loot Crate. And that's something where it's like, I don't care about. Yeah. But, like, no one ever is like, oh, it's selling out or whatever. It's everything is sponsored by something. Whereas, 10 years ago, the moment you got sponsored, it was be screaming out sellout. And I watched a PBS documentary called Generation like a few years ago, where they interviewed like 12-year-olds and they didn't, that terminology sellout wasn't in their head. So I think because like now with social media, everything is a sponsored post. Everything is so widely sponsored that it's just commonplace now that like they're used to it. Whereas, maybe Twitch, maybe it's a little more focused.
Twitch chat wants you to make no money, and they want you to be able to do what you do every day. Like, that's honestly what they want. Because it stems from people getting upset that to see others making money doing probably what they really love.
Yeah.
Because, like, everybody's on Twitch because they love playing video games. Everybody would love to play video games every day for money if you love playing video games. But what people don't realize is everything that goes along with it. And I invite anybody who wants to say that being a Twitch broadcaster is easy to try streaming on Twitch for just 1 week, and I think that you will take back everything you said.
Like, that's the thing too. Like, I've thought about like, should I do Twitch streaming, whatever? But like, ultimately, like, I don't want to do it because one, I don't want to have to focus on entertaining an audience for 8 hours straight, which is like, that's hard. I don't want to talk that long. I can barely talk for an hour without my voice getting strained. But like, because when I play video games, I want to enjoy it, you know? Like, I'll talk with friends
and
multiplayer.
Gaming forever for me.
But yeah, with me, it's forever. Like, I just want to play a video game and enjoy it. I couldn't imagine playing, like, a story game and, like, having to, it would, like, distract it. Because, like, for me, video games are my, like, escape. It's my break. So I just want to play video games and not worry about anything.
And honestly, I'll say there's parts of me that I don't regret being a Twitch broadcaster because everything I do every day, like, is it feels like a dream. I can't believe that I'm doing this and, like, being, like, compensated for it, being recognized for it, and, like, living, like, this life. But at the same time, I miss being able to, like, log on to a game and not being, like, hit up by 1,000 people.
Yeah, so do you...
And just being able to, like, play. But honestly, like, I still do play. And I don't broadcast it. And people hit me up and I just don't respond.
Okay, cool. So that's what I'm going to ask. Like, do you play games outside of when you're actually broadcasting?
I do. Mm-hmm. And people are like, why aren't you streaming? And most of the time I'll be like, yo, I'm not wearing clothes. So, like, and I don't feel like putting them on.
Yeah.
So I'm not streaming. Or I'm just chilling, eating snacks, and I just want to be at my computer doing my thing.
So when you're playing the game, like, by yourself as opposed to broadcasting, do you think internally, are you enjoying it on a different level? Is it a break from it? Or is it still, like, with the cameras on or off, you're in that
zone? This is, like, a really good example. So last night, I'm not, like, great at Hearthstone because I never want to spend money on it. And you have to spend money on it to pretty much be great at it. But I'm, like, convinced I can be great at it without paying to win at all. So I had my friend... one of my moderators for my stream, like, helped me redo my Hearthstone deck last night. And then I probably played, like, 6 to 8 games offline. And the whole time, people were like, why aren't you streaming? And I, you know, sometimes I respond. But most of the time, I just, like, at this point, have gotten, like, so good at, like, ignoring, like, notifications going off. That I just kept playing. And, like, even though I was playing for myself, I was thinking about, oh, I'm excited to play this on stream tomorrow because I think this deck will go well for me and be, like, and produce, like, good streaming content. Yeah. So even though I'm playing the game, like, to enjoy it, I'm still always consciously thinking about, like, my stream.
Okay.
And I would say to people, like, streaming is a 24-hour job. There's never a moment when I'm, like, really not thinking about my stream. Because even when you're away, like, the last 4 days I was away for a wedding, every single day I was still thinking of some way I could connect with my stream audience. Even while I was on vacation. Yeah. And I think it's the same for a lot of YouTubers. Like,
yeah, I mean, like, with me, I'm not so active anymore because I have, like, two other jobs. Like, I have two jobs at work. So, like, but yeah, when I was, like, in college and I had a lot of free time, I would always consciously in the background be mining ideas. Like,
exactly.
Like, oh, what can I do for my YouTube channel? Oh, yeah, you're always, like, conscious of it.
It's 24-hour.
And even, yeah, job. Like, when I'm watching movies, I'm still, like, farming, like, oh, that's a cool technique. I should use that in a video once. Mm-hmm. So, like, I guess if you're an artist or, like, whatever, like, you're always...
I think it comes down to, like, everybody who's streaming and, like, really taking it seriously and, like, that's their passion, they are artists. And putting that out is, like, their artistry. And, like, whether or not you want to think, like, telling jokes and, like, trolling away in games is an art, like, the amount of energy and focus and, like, thought that goes into it is intense and it's exhausting.
Yeah, I mean, it's, yeah, you're definitely performing your hosting.
Even if you're being yourself, which I never really feel like I'm turning anything on or off because I feel like, for the most part, I am myself on my stream, it's still, like, you have to be consciously aware of, like, oh, I'm not going to, like, pick my nose or, like, touch my head in a weird way. Or,
see, like, I feel like that's why I also,
sit
like,
here and zone out in a weird way.
That would be so hard for me to do Twitch streaming, I feel like, because, yeah, I have, like, OCD. So, like, I will, when I play games, I don't know. I feel like there's, like, actions and behaviors I would do where if a camera was on me 24/7, it would, people would be like, what the fuck is, like, it'd be, yeah. It
changes you, like,
yeah, you have to be hyper aware
as a person, and, like, also your ability to play games. So I think it's been really useful because, like, I had, like, some social anxieties that I developed living in New York City just because I was so isolated all the time, like, I'd almost completely forgotten how to, like, talk to people.
Yeah.
And honestly, like, I attribute Twitch, like, not 100%, but, like, probably at least, like, 80% to helping me, like, overcome a lot of those anxieties.
Yeah, I think, like, but you constantly communicating in the chat, you are...
Exactly.
Just, like, that social lubricant of constantly, like, talking and being used
also,
to, like, on your feet.
And also, like, the ability of people to... Because they're typing to me, they're not talking to me, they're able to share, like, similar experiences. They'll be like, yeah, I went through, like, some anxiety and depression, too.
Yeah.
Like, this is what I did that helped me. And I'm able to go back to them and say, this is what I did that helped me. And so, like, it's a level of communication that I literally never thought I would see on the internet that's, like, been really nice.
I think it's cool, like, yeah, being able to be genuine because, yeah.
Which is not how every Twitch channel
is. Exactly, and that's the thing.
Which is not
that's
how
definitely
every Twitch
distinction because, like, yeah, holy shit, like, I hate using, like, PewDiePie as a term because I know, like, he's not even that bad, but, like, that whole vein of, like, hey, guys, like, just the constantly having to be a character, like
I couldn't do
yeah,
it, which is... why I'm not doing a character, which is why I'm just
being
myself.
That's why, because I will, when I check in, you'll be like either playing a game or like, all right, tune in once and you're having like a mini meltdown, like, what the fuck, my computer's not working. Like, it was it was funny. It was
But that's just me. Being real. Like, the second something doesn't work, like, I'm like, I'll freak out.
And like, I think, yeah, and I do ultimately think like a big reason why Twitch particularly is like blown up is like, yeah, whether someone's 14 or whatever, it's just having that like immediate response. Everyone's ultimately like looking for distraction, looking for connections, mm-hmm. wanting to be recognized. Definitely. So here is a big community, almost like tying back to what made WoW so fun. Is like, exactly. It was everyone at once playing something. With Twitch, like, I can understand, at least when like the speedrun stuff's happening, that's cool. It's just like, yeah, everyone checking something out, talking, commenting on it. But yeah, I can see the idea of like, because even as a kid, when I was 14, what I guess would be my Twitch is like, I would spend years on message boards. Just these dumbass message boards, corners of the internet where it'd just be nerds talking. And I guess today, that's now social media and Twitch. Mm-hmm. And like, I view Twitch with like a minor disdain, but like ultimately, like, yeah, if I was younger, it would be message boards and AOL and AIM. So like, it's just the technology shifted a bit.
Yeah.
So like, I'm still like, it's still alien to me, but I think like what you're doing is cool. Like what my friends in A64 do is like, you're trying to make it a show. It's not you just sitting there for 24 hours playing like a zombie, because that's like,
which is what a lot of people do. And honestly, like, I even as a Twitch broadcaster don't understand why those people's streams are successful.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's like not, it's not my job to like make a judgment if like their stream is successful or not. But like personally, like, I just turn those streams off because they're boring. Very cool. So like, that's not what I look for when I look for a Twitch stream.
Yeah. So like,
which is like a big reason why I honestly don't watch a lot of Twitch
streams. That's what I was asking for you. So are there any Twitch streams that you do follow or look at?
The only person that I follow like closely is Soda Poppin, because that was the first Twitch stream that I ever saw, mm-hmm. was him playing. And for me, even though he's been doing this for so long, he's been streaming since before Twitch was Twitch, he's still like, brings an energy to his stream every single day, even though he's done like ridiculous things. Like, he's done I don't even know how many 24-hour streams. He still brings that to his streams, and I'm like, damn, like, I want to be like that guy, in the sense that like, I'm gonna keep that energy, yeah. and like keep going and like persevere, and even through like, he faces like such adversity in his chat. Holy shit, his chat's so mean to him. But, like, he just keeps going.
I get, because I guess there'll always be enough people supporting you that, like, you can tune everything out.
Exactly, which is, like, no matter how, like, trolly his chat's being, he's always going to have his mods and his subs and all these people who've been watching him for years and years now who are going to be like, whatever, these are just spammy people. We're going to keep watching you because this is what we do every day. We watch you. Wow. And, like, this is where we check in every day. And, like, honestly, I don't get to watch his streams as much now because we stream at kind of similar times. But at least once a day, like, later in the night, like, I'll pop into his, like, offline chat and see, like, that people are still talking there, even though he's not streaming.
Like,
which is where, like, I want to get as a broadcaster.
No, I mean, I see, like, that's what it is. Like, yeah, Twitch streaming now, like, that's just today's message boards. Like, I get, and, like, yeah, again, but also, like, even as an adult, I don't go on message boards any much anymore.
Yeah.
But it's just, like, yeah, I think it's just that younger group, and that's where they go. And, like, whatever, they can get all the toxicity out. Like, I get it. I was the same place.
Yeah. I guess, like, we live in such a society now where, like, every single thing you say is so scrutinized.
Yeah.
That I think that people need a place to, like, release that pent-up, like, I just want to say, like,
oh, totally. Like, again, like, I've
the internet's definitely that place. Yeah. Unfortunately, it's good and bad thing, but I think most things are good and bad. Like,
so do you have a lot of, like, familiar faces and friends that you see in the chat every day?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And then there's also, like, people ask me this, too. If I see someone who's usually there every day and they haven't shown up for a couple days or, like, even a week, like, that's concerning to me. And, like, I remember that.
Oh, and you'll hit... Okay,
and I'll hit them up, like, with a message, be like, I haven't seen you in chat.
Very cool. I think, I like that you're creating a nice little host, a nice special place for people. The idea of you saying, like, YouTube creator, I think that's cool. Again, like, I think it's just I'm a little bit older and, like, I'm just too lazy to, like, get back into it and set it up. But, like, that'd be interesting to, like...
It's a huge
for the time commitment. Yeah, the whole creative thing is, like... Because I hypothetically could set up a video editing stream. Because I do
tons
video
editing. Tons of people do that.
Right? Yeah.
But it's on the smaller side now. So you're not going to get the same response that people are going to get, like, streaming games yet. But I'm pretty proud that in the last couple of weeks I've been streaming cosplay making, and I'm getting like close to almost 200 viewers every time.
Which, and are you getting new subscribers every time you do a thing?
It's so, I like, people think that you, when you stream, it's like a flow of donations and subscribers the entire time. But I'll tell you, like, there's more days than not when I don't get any donations and I don't get any subscribers. Mm-hmm. And people are like, doesn't that make you want to quit? And I'm like, no, because it's not really what I'm
doing it for. Yeah, ultimately you're doing it because that's what you want
to
do.
Obviously, I need money to live because I'm a human being, and like living in the United States is pretty ridiculously expensive. Yeah. But at the same time, like, that's not the daily motivator. Like, the daily motivator for me mostly is probably followers. Mm-hmm. Like, being able to grow, like, actual presence and, like, hit all community and not just, like, paid community or people who are willing to contribute financially. Yeah.
So you regard people who don't donate as still human beings?
Yes. Whoa. Yes. Whoa. And you can still win all of the giveaways. Like, nothing will be... Which technically is how it has to be on Twitch, but nobody follows that rule.
So, okay. If anything, I've learned that there are decent human beings who are Twitch streamers.
There are. No, there really are.
Because, yeah, in my head, it's just all donate, gimme, gimme. But, like, I think that's cool. So, yeah, I'll put your links in the description. Like, check out Meghan's Twitch, whatever.
Do it.
It's charming.
It will be fun.
And then, yeah, I don't know. Like, because hypothetically, with this Neighborhood Game Club thing, it may be in the future, I'll set up a thing where, like, once a month, whatever, like, my friends and I'll get together and we'll play the bullshit games we talk about. Like, we'll play Glover. I don't know. Maybe, but, like, for now, I just like doing my little, like, one-on-one show.
No, I think it's really cool.
I like having, like, concentrated material that's up there and people can go back to
it.
And
it's awesome to do stuff face-to-face because so many of, I don't know if you've seen on Twitch, I'm, like, pointing behind me Twitch. The gaming talk shows is, like, a big element of Twitch now, too. So many of them are, like, they're always pulling someone in from Skype and stuff, and it's, like, so much less meaningful to me.
No,
like,
that's why I
want to see people talk
face-to-face. I think hanging out one-on-one is a really
cool
idea.
It produces way, way better, like, interviews because when you're, like, behind your own computer.
Or,
like,
on Skype, yeah, it's, like,
who knows? So who knows? You're sitting there with no pants on, like, no.
Yeah.
Not serious.
Very cool. Well, and also, viewers, listeners, comment below, what are your thoughts on, like, Twitch streaming? Like, do you follow our channels? How old are you? I feel like...
Is everything I'm saying bullshit?
Yeah, I don't know. I generally want to know. And, like, yeah, I feel like the Twitch viewers, probably younger. I think my viewers are mostly my age, a little bit older. The average viewer on YouTube's young. Are you a 12-year-old watching this on YouTube? I don't think so, but hypothetically,
but
let me
you?
Know.
No, I would really like to know, too, so please,
yeah,
if you're 12.
Well, write about the Twitch thing.
If you're 12, please respond.
It's an ongoing discussion I'll have with other people. I'm going to be talking to some older people, especially next week. We might totally trash talk everything. I might 180. We'll see. We might check in with you. But yeah, you have, like, what, 40,000 followers?
I'm approaching 40,000 followers.
That's
so.
Mega64's, like, Twitch thing has, like, 15,000. But on YouTube, they're huge. But, like...
See, that's how it's all different. Like, I just started on Twitch. Like, I only do Twitch. So, like, I'm happy with my, like, my Twitch following. But, like, it's so different how you see, like, wow, these people are huge on YouTube. And then you're like, what the... Yeah. No, why should you want Twitch?
But again,
it makes no sense, though.
Something new might come out, like, next year that will...
Social media, like, is so bad at measuring success.
Yeah. And then again...
Don't measure your success by social
media. Like, because there are people who define themselves by MySpace 10 years ago, and now that's it. Like, Jeffree Star, what's he up to now? You know, like,
he makes makeup now.
Oh, okay. Like, but you know what I mean? Like, something else will come out next year that will completely outdo YouTube, Twitch, or whatever, and there'll be something new.
Always looking forward to the next
Maybe
thing.
Live theater will come back. There'll be
Dude,
a new
I hope so. My brother's a playwright, so that would work out really
there
well
you go. Yeah,
him.
Check out. And that's why next week I'll be talking with an improviser sketch comedian who does theater.
Awesome,
so
cool.
We'll see what's the next step. For now, though,
bye.
Emails. First email is from Nico. He says, hey, Frank, longtime fan. I was wondering if you have ever been to Japan or had any plans to visit.
Ooh.
I haven't been to Japan yet.
Damn, I want to go to Japan.
My girlfriend is Japanese and has relatives, so she's been there a bunch and is like, she just recently went to show me pictures and stuff, so I really want to go back with her. They have a Studio Ghibli museum.
Oh, damn.
Which is like more pristine than Disneyland. It's like, you know, it's a museum. They have artifacts. They have Miyazaki's like books and stuff that he actually uses there. They have shorts. I want to check that out. There's Akihabara or whatever, which is like the big like otaku like mecca.
Oh yeah.
They have like 5-story arcades.
I want to go to Bunny Island.
What's Bunny? Is that where it's just bunnies?
Yeah, it's like some. So they did like tests there during some war. So it's this island just filled with rabbits. It's somewhere in Japan. I really want to go there. They just, like, climb all over
you. Yeah, I've seen pictures of that. And there's, like, cat cafes. There's a, yeah! There's a Final Fantasy 14 cafe, which, like, it's a hybrid, like, gaming cafe you go to play.
I love
But then they also have, like, Moogle dishes and, like, chocobo cakes. Like, it's all, like, cute little pastries modeled after Final Fantasy. And then also, I'm a huge fan of Japanese cinema. I want to... Yeah. They have, The Toho movie studio, which produced Godzilla, outside their studio, they have a giant Godzilla statue.
That's awesome.
So I want to just go and take a picture in front of that. So no, I haven't been to Japan yet, but I want to check it out. I also really want to join the Yakuza, which is the Japanese mafia. So if there's any connections,
I'm not sure that's going to happen for you. I think you're missing a little, some of the requirements.
You need a back tattoo and that's it.
Oh shit. Yeah.
There's also
That can happen easily.
There's Japan has a huge sex industry, but they don't serve whites. So, but they don't. But they have maid cafes.
What?
They also have
that's totally unfair.
They also have cafes. My friend told me about this where the hosts are women dressed up as boys, and they and it's for women. So it's
Yuri.
It's girls seeing girls dressed up as men and they act like men, and so like it's this. Kind of unique
thing.
Dude,
that shit's big in Japan.
She told me about that. It sounds fascinating. Again, I'm a man. I can't go there, but that sounds dope. So no, I haven't been to Japan yet, but I want to. The rest of Nico's email is like, hey, you guys are into PC games. This is what this whole episode's about.
I hope you enjoyed it, Nico.
I know. He says, he literally says, talk about like Half-Life 2 and Warcraft. I will say though, with like the Valve's games, have you played like Half-Life or Half-Life 2 or Portal?
I was like a little on the young side for that. Like that, I didn't have a PC during those times.
All those games are beatable in like one sitting. Should stream it.
I have them. You should stream it. My biggest hesitation would be like, do people not want to watch this?
Well, do what you want to do.
Honestly, that's kind of like.
But the also, I feel like 14-year-olds haven't seen Half-Life. And again, you should play it. Watch it. But
I'll say to that, it's taken me a while to develop that attitude because people are hardcore about what they want to see you play.
Yeah.
Like, I'll be playing a game and it will just be endless rides to switch to another game. So, like, I've just kind of grown into like my confidence.
Once you're big enough,
I'm gonna play whatever I want.
You can dictate what you want. But yeah, Half-Life 1 is amazing because it's more of a horror. It starts out as a horror game and then it goes like sci-fi and then batshit action. And then Half-Life 2 is its own thing. I don't know. Half-Life games are amazing and then Portal's fun. Also, have you ever played Ski Free? It's like a Windows 95 game where you're a little skier. You have to dodge Yetis.
Yes, I have seen that. I have not played.
You should stream Ski Free. There's also Chips Challenge, which is like an 80s. It's like a dungeon crawler where you have to like. It's like you're a hacker inside a computer chip and you have to like push blocks.
I need you to say like a specified date or specified day of the week where I'm like, I'm gonna play whatever I
want. Play old ass weird games. No one. Ski Free and Chips Challenge.
No complaints.
Those are good.
Immediate ban on first complaint. Like.
And then another email. Do you want to read this one? Just read the email from Stevie B.
What was a game you bought when you were younger that by today's standards you would completely ignore when looking for a new game? An example, for me, it was Over the Hedge, an adaptation game that I got for the GameCube.
Yeah, so...
That's awesome, by the way. That's totally awesome, and thank you for admitting that, Steve.
When I was a kid, like, licensed games were terrible, but, like, as when you're a kid, you're dumb, you don't read reviews. So I would buy every licensed game.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I mean, there's good ones, like, GoldenEye's
they
great.
They just poop them out. Yeah. Like, that's the whole
but
process.
Like, I would buy stuff like The Fifth Element and, like, the South Park game, which by today's standards are awful, but I loved them because I love The Fifth Element. I love South Park. But, yeah, today, I definitely, like, look at reviews before buying games, unless it's something I absolutely know I'm gonna like. I avoid licensed games, but... Like, the new South Park game, Stick of Truth, the new Shadow of Mordor. Like, those are actually good games. So they're getting to a higher level of quality. Another thing I was obsessed with when I was a kid were M-rated games. Like, the gorier they were. As, like, a 10-year-old.
So was everyone, because you were, like, had to get your mom to buy it for you. It felt so badass.
Exactly. So, yeah, as a kid...
it felt like you were getting away with something.
As a kid, if I saw an M-rated game, it was like, hell yeah, I want this. As an adult, it's like, that I don't give a shit. Actually, now, if a game has too much swearing or too much violence that it's cartoony, I'm, like, turned off by it. Like, I recently played Kane and Lynch, which is, like, a crime game. These two gangsters, and they're constantly yelling, fuck. Like, so much that it's, like, I feel like this is made for 12 or... Like, it's reverse, where it's not mature, it's cartoonish.
Definitely.
Licensed games and M-rated games. I mean, I'll still play them if they're good. But, yeah, I definitely look at reviews now. Next email is from Charles. Hey, Frank, what are your thoughts on the steady dwindling of couch co-op games? More and more games focus on online multiplayer, and many do not even offer group play. I was raised on Nintendo, so I strongly value playing games with friends in the same room together. I'm the same exact way. Mm-hmm. Growing up with, like, friends, going over to friends' houses... I love, like, local co-op games. And I think Nintendo did this better than anyone. Like, Nintendo 64 with four players, even GameCube, like Smash Brothers, Mario Kart, like Mario Party, like those are all of my favorite gaming memories. But yeah, now today with everything shifting to online play, a lot of games don't offer single, like, two-player experiences on the same screen because everything has to be 1080p, 60 frames per second. And if you try to dual screen it, there's like yeah, there's like fidelity loss. So now games don't even offer it. Like the new Halo, Halo 5, is it going to have co-op online, but not couch co-op? Which is like, that's the only way I've ever played those games.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah, so
it'll be different.
So I think it sucks that like not so many games are focusing on that, but there's still a few games. Have you ever played any of the Lego games?
So long ago. Like, so long ago.
Lego Harry Potter. My girlfriend loves Harry Potter, so we played, like, Lego Harry Potter.
I think I have Lego Harry
Potter. Yeah, we played both those games in, like, the span of, like, a week, and it was... I had so much fun. Diablo 3, the PS4 version's great, local co-op. The Gauntlet games. But yeah, there's a website called Co-Optimus. I'll put a link. And the whole point of Co-Optimus is they review co-op games, and specifically couch co-op. So it's like, they're all about two-player games. And again, it's such a specific site, but they do game reviews. Like, yeah, I don't know. So Co-Optimus, if you like couch co-op games. But yeah, like the Wii U has Mario Kart 8 or whatever. That game's awesome. But
yeah, Wii U is still really the only console doing it. Like the other consoles are not about.
Yeah, it's all about online.
Not about friendship.
Yeah, they're Sony and Microsoft are anti-friendship. And then also, like, last episode I talked about beat 'em ups, like Final Fight, Castle Crashers, those are great beat-em-up games. Metal Slug's good. Yeah, I don't know. Even going to the arcades, playing those are good. And then last question is from my friend Jared. He asked, do you guys ever go to garage sales? I heard you go to Goodwill and other places, but I was kind of shocked you don't go to garage sales. You can get some great stuff from people who are moving. He talks about how last week he got a stack of PS2 games for $5.
Damn.
Because, yeah, I collect old video games. That's what we talk a lot on the
garage
show.
Garage sales are, like, a dying thing.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the biggest part of it.
Because now everything's on Craigslist. But, like, with me, I do want to check out garage sales so I can get lucky. But you have to wake up at, like, 7 in the morning on a Saturday.
No.
So.
That's why I hate garage sales.
Yeah, so, like, I'm tempted. I really want to. But it's, like, I wake up on a Saturday at, like, 10, and it's, like,
And then you always have the chance of running into, like, a stingy old person who's, like, does this young person know this is worth something?
Yeah, I don't know.
I shall charge them more.
But, like, but I do want to check out a swap meet and a garage sale.
Swap meets would be good
for. So I do want to check it out, so we might do a whole special.
But they always, but the swap meet people you got to watch, too, because they sometimes know the value of stuff.
They know. But, yeah.
So.
But, like, yeah, because, like, I go, there's this Reddit called Game Collecting, and every weekend it's people being like, oh, I got this at a garage sale, and it's, like, a stack of N64 games for $10. So you can get lucky, but I haven't checked it out because I don't want to wake up early. That will be this week's episode of Neighborhood Game Club. Check out Meghan or Snugzmeow, Snugzpow, whatever. Check out our Twitch stream. Check out our Instagram for cosplays. Continue to watch Neighborhood Game Club. Send in emails. We got a lot more episodes coming up. Exciting. I'm still an old person. I don't fully get Twitch, but maybe Meghan will teach you.
I can tell you things.
She'll teach
about the internet.
You how to make a Murloc cosplay for the next BlizzCon.
It's true. I'm making one right now. You can come watch.
Follow her, bug her to play Final Fantasy 14, because that's the best MMORPG. And then lastly, can you have your cat say Neighborhood Game Club looking at the camera?
Surprise! Surprise!
All right, I don't think that was a show cat. He's not professional. Get a dog instead.
Oh.